I'm Ken Steele. Welcome to another 10 with Ken. This week, join me in Brandon, Manitoba at Assiniboine Community College. No, Assiniboine. Like the river? I sat down at ACC's beautiful North Hill campus to chat with President Mark Frison about their challenges encouraging enrollment in a region with the lowest post-secondary participation rate in the country and recent growth in international enrollment of more than 1,500%.
And so we went from about 30 in 2013 to over 500 last year. So fairly substantial growth in a fairly short period of time.
This week, Mark Frison on his college's role as an engine of immigration and participation on the prairies. Mark, thanks for taking some time to sit down and chat with me.
Great to have you here, Ken.
Well, can you tell me about this beautiful building that we're in?
Well, this is the Manitoba Institute of Culinary Arts, and this is part of the former Brandon Mental Health Centre. This particular building was a residence for nurses and is actually one of the top heritage properties in the province. It has the sort of same feel that you might get at a St. Evex, at Acadia, or Mount A.
Over the next few decades, ACC has ambitious plans to develop the North Hill campus, preserving historic buildings, constructing new academic and athletic facilities, and experiential learning spaces.
I think, you know, as that dream comes to reality in a more full way, I think that's going to be a great thing for Assiniboine because it has an ability to set us apart from anybody else in the country.
Are there some innovations or some new initiatives at Assiniboine Community College that you think would serve as examples to other institutions in Canada or elsewhere?
Certainly one of the things that's been driving us has been a recent college review. And that review revealed a number of things, and one of them is that Manitoba has the lowest post-secondary participation rate in the country. Yeah. It's been that way for a long time. You know, when I was in Saskatchewan as a president of a college there, I often used to joke that we didn't have the lowest in the country, but we could see it from there. You know, we were the second lowest. And so when I came to Manitoba 8 years ago, it was certainly something we were concerned about, and it's been great to see it put front and center through this college review. I'm from Nova Scotia originally, right? I mean, you can't throw a baseball without hitting a college or a university campus. Right. Whereas here in Manitoba, things are more highly centralized. And so, you know, Winnipeg does fairly well with 85% of the spending there. Brandon does okay. But then we have other pockets around the province that have sort of deserts. So places like Portage, Dauphin has less access, Winkler, Morden. And so that's one of the things the reviews told us is we've got to do a better job of that. And so about 5 years ago in 2013, our board set out a plan to double the number of graduates by 2025. Mm. And so we've been ambitiously pursuing that. It required about 6% growth a year. And over that period, we haven't received any new program funds. So everything's been self-generated. The other area that's certainly significant for the province and probably our largest public policy challenge on the prairies is how do we bridge the prosperity gap between Indigenous and non-Indigenous populations? Right. And so for an organization like ours, you know, in any given year, we are probably between 15% and 22%. I think during my time, the students have been Indigenous. This past year, for example, we would have run programs on or close to 20 First Nations communities. So that has been a focus of our efforts, is how do you get around the entire province to offer those programs.
And you've also seen some growth with international recruitment.
Yeah, international has been probably the largest single element of the change. Back in 2010-11, we actually struck a task force to look at a number of things which the college previously looked at sort of separately. What we were doing around international students, what we were doing to serve newcomers to Canada, how we were giving our own students international perspectives, and what we were doing around international development work. ACC had been a big player in international development up until the mid-90s. And then had stopped at that point. But we wanted to look at those, were there interrelationships between them? So we had a group on campus, a task force, that looked at that for about 16 months and came back with a series of recommendations, number one of which was to grow our international enrollment. And so we went from about 30 in 2013 to over 500 last year. So fairly substantial growth in a fairly short period of time.
Yeah.
In the early days of that expansion, most of our international growth was in Winnipeg. And part of the reason was that the housing market in Brandon was very hot. We had a 0.5% vacancy rate. And then we couldn't integrate with the great program assets and faculty that we had here.
Right.
Right? And so, you know, as the housing market here has eased, as new stocks come on the market, that's been better. But eventually, in order to serve that population, you're going to need to have on-campus residences.
Certainly, Cape Breton University's reported some pretty meteoric increases in international lately as well.
Now driven for very different reasons. You know, our international strategy is highly tied to provincial immigration efforts. Manitoba has long been a leader among small provinces for immigration. And here, that's what we see is lots of the folks who are interested in coming to Assiniboine are looking to come to Manitoba. And so they see our programs as a pathway. Whereas if I take my alma mater, Cape Breton University, the challenges there are more fundamental in terms of demographic challenges on the island. And so for the sustainability of the institution, they need large numbers of international students if the locals are going to still continue to have access. So the drivers are very different. And that's certainly one of the things you see in some parts of the country. International has often been driven by their financial situation. And in our case, our financial situation didn't enter into the equation about whether we got into the business or not.
Can you talk at all about what strategies have driven the meteoric increase in international enrollments? Is there anything you're willing to talk about, your secrets?
Well, I don't know if there's any secrets, but certainly the thing that's probably counterintuitive to most is that the number one recommendation to us when we started out was to increase our tuition fees. We were at about two times tuition, and Manitoba has a very low tuition fee environment to start with. And so we used a two times multiplier for international students.
Reflecting tuition plus grant and more or less covering their costs?
It didn't really cover the costs. That was one of the challenges. 5 years ago, we moved to four times tuition fees, and that became helpful in recruiting more students.
Yeah, you've got to spend on recruiting, you've got to spend on supports. You need at least as much money per student with an international student as you would with a domestic student.
Our low tuition fee environment still remains one of the challenges, because at even four or five times tuition fees, it's still, for some programs, where there's large provincial labor market demand, it doesn't pay its own way. So for example, the province would love to have us bring in more folks to take a heavy-duty mechanic. But when you look at that in terms of what you'd need to charge, it's still beyond the pale of five times tuition fees. I think the institution needs to do all that it can to foster economic development. And so making sure that our programs align, I think, is incredibly important. We've been fortunate in that our programs have excellent outcomes in terms of graduates. But I think there's more that we can do there. So, you know, when I talked about immigration efforts, our international strategy is hand in glove with what the province is trying to do around immigration, much of which has been driven by labor market factors. You know, even though there are some programs you know you could fill and there'd be, you know, lots of demand and they'd pay their own way, we've been hesitant to do it unless it's hand in glove with that immigration strategy. You know, we're doing some interesting things right now with the food processing sector, right? Maple Leaf's flagship plant is here in Brandon. We've got some big investment in a plant in Neepawa and High Life. And so we're looking at what we can do around industrial meat cutters, retail meat cutting. Manitoba's going to have a fair amount of investment, close to $1 billion in the agriculture sector in Portage, the Prairie alone. You know, how do we make sure that we have the labor that they need for those particular industries? Again, tied not just to how we help train people for that industry, but how do we use those training assets as a way to foster people into the immigration system? Again, that can then go work in those particular industries as part of their desire to come to Canada. Well, those are the things that I think that, that we have to be unapologetic about pursuing.
Well, thank you very much, Mark. This has been an interesting conversation, lots of food for thought, and thanks for bringing me out to Assiniboine College, too, because I enjoyed my morning talking about international and looking forward to the afternoon and the evening with two other groups.
It's great to have you here.
Thanks for having me.
My interview with Mark continues next week as we discuss ways campus leaders can inspire their people to take ownership and take initiative. To be sure you don't miss it, take a moment to subscribe. My thanks to Sean Cameron for coordinating the on-site recording at ACC. And thank you for watching. This week, join me in Brandon, Manitoba at Assiniboine Community College.
Got that bug.
Assiniboine.
In academic contexts, well, does that matter that light is on?
Just give me one second here. We'll cut there down now.